sorry.
So, you know, Baba had said that in samskaras, I don't know, he said that you gather samskaras even when you see, you think, and obviously when you do. So, do we not gather samskaras when we are thinking or a thought comes to our
mind? Good question. I would interpret it as yes, anything that you do creates samskaras. Thoughts create samskaras which are very feeble. It's very light, very weak. You know, then feelings slightly and action cross. So those samskaras are very, very weak. Right? But when those another secret, so to speak, Baba had said, you know, to one of the persons in the interview, is that let the thoughts come and go. On the contrary, it is helpful. Baba says you encourage such thoughts to come so that with the, am I making sense?
Okay, yeah.
With the thoughts coming, you are exhausting the battery charged, which is of gross, and it is being gradually weakened without putting it into action. If you put it into action, yes, if you put it into action, then this immediately gets exhausted because you already, let's say, succumbed to some gross desire or you have exhausted that. But in the process, you have accumulated fresh one. So just to give an example, supposing there is 10 unit of, just an example, 10 unit of samskaras which desire, you fulfill that. So 10 is over, yes, you have fulfilled. But in the process, you accumulated 12. It's like that. And it's an ongoing process. So the point at which you can cut this cycle is to stop acting on those desires. You cannot cut it at the thought level or emotions or feeling level because that is beyond us. So the only point where we can cut it is the action level. That is what Baba says. So when you cut it, you got it. Because we are responsible for actions. We are so gross, so we are responsible for actions.
So it means if I want to slap someone, instead of slapping that person, I keep on thinking about it and
correct.
Don't slap.
Yes.
Just an example.
From Baba's discourse, it seems that, yeah. But I would also feel that you could go into a kind of a self-analysis. Like, why would I like to slap
you?
Why would I want to slap you? Isn't it? You know, when you really self-reflect, there is a possibility that you might be able to exhaust all those desires to slap, you know, and then a time may come when it has no power over you. You will understand.
Yes, exactly. So that's what I'm saying. Instead of acting on it, just think about it and then just take Baba's name.
Yes, yes.
Maybe that negative feeling will go away.
And another, good that I had this in mind. Then Baba says that when you take my name, when you get such desires, then also you do not accumulate fresh samskaras. So that name has such a power. What were you saying, sir?
The
patterns
in the cross is so different.
So that was, Baba, this is the example that Baba had given, you know, that I think it was to some Parsi gentleman, and Parsis like dansak. So something like, you know, that supposing you are eating and the plate of dansak has fallen on a table or whatever, you know. So what you just remove, easily removable, the pieces of whatever, you know, dal and mutton and rice and all that. So that is like easily removable, mental samskara, like remove. Then you may have to little bit, you know, thoda achha sa clean karke. So those are like, you know, subtle samskaras. And still there will be that stain over there, that stain. So those are like gross because they are very deeply embedded in our consciousness. And that's needs a little ghasav, you know, ghasampati. You know, they'll need a hard brush and you have to keep on like a dhobi, push, you know, that way. So Baba emphasized that. So in a nutshell, you know, if we get so-called negative thoughts from Baba's standpoint, okay, if you don't get it, it's very good, but if you get it, there's no need to fret and fume and get, you know, disturbed about it. Just keep taking Baba's name and just observe those thoughts. Let them come, let them go. Don't entertain them. Many times, you know, we have no thoughts, so we just bring some thoughts from the past and bring it in the present and play around with it. So I'm not sure whether what will be the consequences of those thoughts. Mm-hmm. But basically, Baba said that if some thoughts just come, just observe, be a witness to it, let it come, let it go without putting them into action. Don't try to, I mean, don't force yourself into controlling it. Here also Baba says, you know, it's something like when you suppress it, you know, it may get suppressed, you know, for a time being, and then all of a sudden it might just spring up at a moment when your guards are a little down, you know, when you are not very guarded. So just let it come, let it go. And one discourse Baba says, encourage it to come and go and exhaust your samskaras only through thoughts and not into action. These are, I think, more or less Baba's words. Exhaust them, encourage them, exhaust them, and do not, only in thought, let it be exhausted. And after all, thoughts are what? It is nothing but what comes out of my, you know, past samskaras. So as the thoughts are coming, that samskaras also loosen itself, you know, it becomes weaker and feeble and all that.
Okay. But what if there are some bad samskaras that you have to... There are some bad samskaras that you have to go through, like you said, that 10. So let us say I am supposed to slap that person.
Okay.
And I don't. I don't put it into action.
Good, so that's what she's saying, no. So then those samskaras will lose its impact over a period of time. If you do a self-reflect and say, why should I slap you? Why would I want to slap you? What is it that is irking me to slap you? And when you do a little self-talk or self-reflect, there is a possibility that those samskaras will not bother, it will not bother you at all, it will just go away.
Okay, sometimes, you know, just honestly telling to Baba that I really want to slap this person. And when you say that, actually the thought weakens.
It feels
yes,
away.
Yes, yes.
And next day you get up thinking that there's no need of such an action.
Exactly. So there is so much of power in Baba's name, you know, that we can really, I'm using the wrong word, but we can really play with that word, you know, to help us come out of this, right? So that was the, we talked about the grinding wheel.
The flash from the eternal. The act of a perfect master is not repetitive. It is not merely the redoing of something previously experienced in the context of a new setting. It is the doing of something that cannot be done within the restrictions of the experiences of duality. It is a creation of the utterly new, a descent of the truth into the false. Hence, its creativity is infinite. The redeeming act of a perfect master is a flash of the eternal in the midst of what is otherwise nothing but rigidly determined causation. This is the mystery of divine grace bestowed by the perfect master.
Okay. Baba had once said, you know, when somebody asked Baba about the divine plan, so Baba said, you know, the divine plan is that there is no plan. That means every moment for the perfect ones, for the perfect masters, for the avatar, it's a moment of spontaneity. It just spontaneously happens. Like Baba says, I don't have to think. He doesn't have to think or plan. It just happens. So here, what I'm trying to, of course we'll read through this, but from whatever little that we understood was that the act of a perfect master to bestow his grace upon anyone who is in duality is something which is totally out of the world. It's not something that it is repetitive, that is, it is not something, because most of the actions of most of the people are governed by the law of cause and effect, karma, most of it. But here, as we all know, that the domain of the law, or should I, is the dominion, I would say the dominion, I am supreme, of the law of karma is the domain of illusion. Once you are out of illusion, there is no dominion of the law of karma because you are above law. The grace is above law. Most of us, every one of us, I would say rather, are in that pendulum of cause and effect, cause and effect, cause and effect. Everything is happening according to the law of causation for everybody. We are basically slaves of our own past karmas and all that. So what Baba is trying to say is, the flesh from the eternity, is that when the grace comes, because it is beyond the law, it is totally different. That has no logic, that has no law, it just comes, it is spontaneous, it is something which is creative, and it just vanishes out, or whosoever it descends, it just, as we say, basam, you know, a basam of his entire karmic entanglement. So now with that background, we try to understand what Baba is trying to say. The flesh from the eternal, it's a flesh. The act of a perfect master is not repetitive. Most of our acts are repetitive, if you look at it. Most of our responses are reactive in nature to all the stimuli that we see. They're all reactive. It is not merely the redoing of something previously experienced in the context of a new setting. Redoing would mean repetitive. Redoing would mean reactive. We tend to be very reactive in our nature, you know. It is not that, Baba says. It is the doing of something that cannot be done within the restrictions of the experiences of duality. The experiences of duality are within restrictions. And the restrictions are imposed by the law of karma. It is within that. Everything, we are all playing within the law of karma. We are all reactive human beings. We are all repetitively doing what we have been doing over the years. Baba says the act of the perfect master is not that. That's what Baba is trying to say. It is a creation of the utterly new, a descent of the truth into the false. It is a descent of the truth, which is beyond any law, beyond the law of karma, beyond the law of causation, into the false. Hence, its creativity is infinite. You can imagine the creativity of that, whatever you call flesh, that the, I would look at it that way, that the creativity is so great that the creature realizes that I am the creator. You got me? Means that flesh which descends on anybody, the creativity is so great because we are all creatures. We don't experience as creator. The creature becomes the creator. The creature realizes, oh, I am the creator. That is the, yeah, you have something.
What you seem to have said and we've understood is this, it is a singular thing, cause effect. And now suddenly there is something which is perhaps so much more,
yes,
so multidimensional.
Yes.
And that is then, you know.
Absolutely. And nothing to do with this cause and effect. It is something you can say foreign, but something very different, yeah. Very beautiful. It is a creation of the utterly new, a descent of the truth into the false. Hence, its creativity is infinite. Because it is so, creativity is so infinite that he makes the person who is the recipient himself becomes infinite. In a sense, I would look at it that way. The redeeming act of a perfect master is a flesh of the eternal in the midst of what is otherwise nothing but rigidly determined causation. How beautiful, Baba. Whatever is happening here is nothing but a rigidly determined causation. Everything cause, effect, rigid. Rigid, tight. But here Baba says that the redeeming act of a perfect master is a flash of the eternal in the midst of what is otherwise nothing but rigidly determined causations.
They are so spontaneous.
They are spontaneous.
We are rigid.
This is the mystery of divine grace bestowed by the perfect master. This is the mystery. They do not obviously they don't function at the law level because they are beyond law. There is above everything is. So that's why when somebody something like ask what if somebody has done so many wrong things, this, that, Baba's grace, you know, because grace is beyond law, it supersedes all the karmas. If Baba's grace is there, then it doesn't, then nothing, all is finished, all is finished. Like somebody had asked me that Baba's sixth wish, I say with my divine authority to each and all that whosoever takes my name at the time of breathing his last comes to me. So do not forget to remember me in your when your end approaches. That's what it was. So somebody asked, what if somebody has done all kinds of nonsense in life, but he remembers Baba? And when I say Baba, it means any God's name, you know, at the time of breathing his or her last. Would he get mukti? Because when Baba was asked, you know, what does it mean by comes to me? So Baba said, you know, that Charles Purdom, C.B. Purdom, he asked Baba, what is the meaning of comes to me? And Baba clarified that comes to me means that soul achieves liberation or mukti or moksha and he experiences infinite bliss eternally. And there is no more coming birth and death, no more reincarnation for that soul. And then Baba also went ahead to explain that this is not perfection. It doesn't mean perfection, because perfection is in the body, where you experience infinite knowledge, infinite power, infinite bliss. Whereas this soul, as we call it, you know, the Najat Mukti or ordinary Mukti, normally you get it after death. Sometimes even 3 to 5 days after that, and at that time there is no body, so there is no question of experiencing infinite knowledge and infinite power, you know, because only that particular soul experiences infinite bliss. So somebody said that if somebody asked, you know, not ask Baba, somebody asked me that if somebody were to do like this, what do you mean to say? He will get it. He will get mukti. So my limited understanding, I said, with my limited understanding, I said, yes, for one, because Baba said so. There's no further argument. But if you now, when you intellectualize, let's intellectualize. First of all, it's not so easy to remember him when you are breathing your last. So many other thoughts may assail you. You try to remember him, like Baba said, first thing in the morning, 12 noon, 5 in the evening, last thing before you go to bed. Even that sometimes becomes difficult, you know. So when you are actually breathing your last, would it be really easy? Not so easy. Second thing, you know, that whatever you may have done here, this is how I explain, you know, you are doing this in the realm of illusion. I hurt somebody, I kill somebody, I did this, I did that, whatever it is, it's in the realm of illusion. And I give an example. Supposing you are asleep and in your dream, you have murdered a few people. You murdered in your dream. Now, there's an advocate here, so I have to be very careful. Now when you wake up, would you be punished for the murders you committed in your dream? The obvious answer is no. So from the standpoint of the seers, from the standpoint of truth, from the standpoint of Baba, you know, all this is a dream. So whatever we have done is in a dream. So when you are awakened into that state, you will not be answerable for this. Am I making sense? Or no? So in other words, what I am trying to say is, because Baba promised that whosoever takes my name at the time of breathing his last comes to me, I personally feel, and I am in a sense putting a lot of weightage to that, you know, that we have to trust that word and try to remember him when we breathe our last, so that we are able to get into moksha or mukti or liberation or salvation and not being born again. Somebody again told me, you know, that no, I don't want mukti and moksha. I want to serve Baba. I want to come back and be with Baba and love him all the more, love him and serve him in all this room. So what have I got to say? Then I said, in that case, you have to remember not to remember him when you breathe your last. You remember not. Only then that is possible. Number two. Number three, my logic goes like this, you know. But that is what you want. You want to come and serve him. But what is it that he wants? He wants one headache less, as I said, you know. So, and there are so many cases, live cases, you know, where we all know that Pilamai, Baba's spiritual sister, when she got to know that Baba travels in very third class crammed compartments, you know, she very lovingly made some kind of a chair or a stool which was folding and brought it for Baba, and they were traveling together. Baba was there, Pilamai was there, some Mandli was there, and she opened it very happily and proudly and said, Baba, this is for you, you sit. And Baba said, no, you sit. And she said, no, Baba, how can I sit? I have made it specially for you with so much of love. Whatever. And Baba said, no, you sit. So this, you sit, pahle aap, it happened. And then she said, no, I am not worthy of sitting on this chair because it was made specially with you in mind. But then, what did Baba do? Took the stool and threw it out of the running train. And very beautiful, Baba said, you give more importance to your own sentiments about the stool rather than giving more importance to my words and to obedience. So I am joining that to, I wish that I should come back and serve Baba. Mm. Yeah, that is your wish, but that is your wish. What is Baba's wish? What does Baba want? Baba, in that document called My Wish, he is saying this. So who am I to say, no, Baba, I want to serve you and all that, you see. So that, there are many such stories about the sandals also, where Baba said, put on my sandals and go. And the person, was it Vishnu? Vishnu. He bowed down to the sandal, and you know, that when Baba was so angry. That means we are so self-centered in a sense, you know, that we give so much of more importance to our own interpretation of what is right and what is wrong, to our own sentiments about some sandal, rather than disobeying Baba's, rather than obeying Baba's words. So it's like that. So when such stories come up, you know, we do feel that, oh yes, we tend to not think clearly, let's put it that way. I remember once, I think, similar, I don't know whether it was Baba's first visit to Quetta or whatever, KT and Gawel Irani, you know, their Rusi Pop, they were staying there, and Baba, I think, gave some cut an apple and put it at KT's mouth. KT Irani, we all know. Mm-hmm. Huh? And Baba said, nahi Baba, tumhe khao. You know, it's very natural for Baba, you eat karke. And Baba was furious. Haven't you taught your Gawel, he's telling Gawel, haven't you taught your younger sister any manners? Doesn't she know that you should never refuse anything which is given by the avatar? You know, somehow there is a misconception, and we do that. Yes.
So I'm done.
You're still on karma.
Yeah, I'm still on samskaras.
Go beat the person.
Go and meet him up. Yeah, we'll come with you. We will come with you and meet him up.
I don't want to beat him.
Take a little bit of your karma also.
But if it really doesn't matter when you go in the other space, like when. It doesn't matter, like you said, when you're in the dream, what you do,
right.
It doesn't matter. So maybe we are meant to do that. I'm just talking about very natural, like we consider these things like bad, like we consider hypocrisy, lust and everything bad, but Baba has said so.
Yes.
So when those thoughts come in our head, we obviously would try to not go ahead with that and remember Baba and Dada. But what if we are supposed to like experience those sanskaras, you know, to sort of our balance sheet gets whatever, like good and bad sanskaras. What if we're supposed to experience that? And the other query is that when we have other thoughts, like which are not really bad, but they're thoughts like I need to get ahead in my career. So they're not really thoughts about Baba, but things like that, where you get competitive and all of those things. And like, how do you deal with that? Because at the end, that is all to do with sort of the lower forms.
At the end of the day, whatever you do, karmas are always going to be there.
Yeah.
And the easiest way out is to invite him in whatever you do.
Okay.
That's what Baba says, you know.
Difficult.
That
that's like the answer to everything. Why do I even
take?
It's
not
difficult.
But don't you think that's what he wants, you know? Okay, if you are in a career line, of course you would like to, nothing wrong in that, that you want to be, you want to be the head of
you,
the department.
You are, you're holding
it's perfectly
your skills,
okay.
And what are you doing in the bargain?
Perfectly
actually, you're
okay.
Glorifying him
perfectly
with the skill
okay.
That has been bestowed on you to bring cheer and goodness within your the perimeter of your work environment. So it is always so nice to rise up. In fact, you're rising up to the incapability that you are. You know, then you're raising your
it's perfectly
your,
okay.
Your benchmark
like
to capable to be a finer human being.
See, basically, what is important is no attachment. Everything being done for him, right? I'll give you an example where you know where somebody said that Baba, is it wrong to make money and do business and make money? Because it's money business. And Baba very beautifully said, there is nothing wrong even if you own the whole world. As long as you do not allow yourself to be owned by any part thereof. Which means what is perfectly okay to you, really be very vigorous in your business and this and that, but don't be attached to it. Not to be owned by any part thereof means not to be attached to it. So the same thing goes for every little thing, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody asked Baba that I have been drafted for war, now what do I do? Do I go, do I not go? Because killing is not good. Now for us it is not good and all. We talk about right and wrong, good and bad from standpoint of Advaita truth. There's nothing right or nothing wrong. It's just that you do something and you get consequences. You have to face the consequences. So Baba said very beautifully that yes, if you have to go, if you can avoid, fine. If you have to go, go. If you are posted in the, you know, on the front, do. If you are supposed to shoot, shoot. But do it as a matter of duty. Do not do it, you know, out of enmity. Do not do it out of hatred. Do not feel the joy of having killed 100,000 people or whatever it is. Just do it in a very dispassionate manner because it is your duty to do it. So through all these question answers that happen, we are so fortunate to get a very clear-cut pathway of what Baba's thoughts, what Baba wants us to do. So it's like that. Somebody had asked Baba a very intelligent question. Baba, I'm going to do something and I know it is something wrong. It is not right. It is, you call it sinful. It is sin. Am I ultimately responsible for it? Question mark. And Baba being Baba is Ustad ke Ustad. He himself says, I am the Ustad of Ustad. He nodded his head, no. You are not ultimately responsible for it. The ultimate responsibility is all mine. But you will have to face the consequences. Which means what? The law of karma will operate on you. But responsibility, fine, because I created...
So what does it mean? We are talking consequences. Life is consequences.
I created the entire creation. So ultimately for everyone and everything, I am responsible. Because I am the, as they say, mischievous chicken. You know, if you read nothing and everything. So I am responsible for everything. But I am responsible. But you have to face the consequences. It's like that. So very many people, you know, once we are clear in our head, as to what, then by and large, today somebody had called me, something to do with, you know, that I don't even know the person, some lady, and she said that something to do with God's will, again the same thing, the helpuri of will and wish and all that, so what if I do, if because otherwise I would never have done because it was God's will, you know, I said you forget about the will and all that, you know, be focused on God's wish rather than will. Because Baba has said, my will is law. Baba has said this. And my wish governs the law. And my love sustains the universe. So my wish is, my will is law, which means what? My interpretation is that everything happens according to the law. The rule is that there are scriptures written that not a leaf has the power to quiver or shake without my will. Sign, God, G-O-D. Right? Correct. But it is happening according to law. Why is the leaf moving? Because there is wind. Simple as that. Why is the wind flowing? Because there is some pressure. There is some... So, no, what I am trying to say is, everything happens according to the law. If I jump out of the fourth floor and I break my neck or break my back and all that, it is happening according to law, the law of gravity. Isn't it? Everything is happening according to the law. So you can't, then the example that I give, which I always give is, supposing I murdered somebody and the case went on, Jamshed tried level best to save me, but nothing happened, then final verdict. Last judgment, you know. At that time, they normally tell, you know, Baba, aapka koi last wish hoega, to bolo karke. And I tried to act smart. I said, sir, you are a very educated person, very religious person. You know, have you ever come across in your religious scriptures? Because I have come across, you know, that God says that not a leaf has the power to shake or quiver without God's will. Yes, I have read it. Judge says, yes, I have read it. Then, aapi socho, you only think, how can I murder somebody unless it was God's will? So that means it was God's will, so why should I be punished and all that? So judge both smart. So he takes that hammer and does what? Hang unto death. Oh, you can't do this, you can't do this, how can you do this? He says, yes. See, if it was God's will that my hammer would not go down, then my hand would have been stuck here. You know, but because it was God's will, you know, that's why it went down. You see, so in other words, if it is God's will, you have to accept everything as God's will. In other words, you only face the consequences of whatever you do. Good, bad, right, wrong, everything. So once we understand, don't be high funder, God's will. God's will is law. It is a law. Everything happens. He's just imagine, so smart God is, you know. वो झंझट में पढ़ने का ही नहीं ही इंस्टीट्यूटेड अ लॉ ऑफ कर्म सो मेटिक्युलस सो परफेक्ट सो बारीक दैट यू कैन नॉट डू एनीथिंग जस्ट एवरीथिंग हैपेंस अकॉर्डिंग टू द लॉ ऑटोमेटिकली बाय डिफॉल्ट यू नो ही डजंट हैव टू सी एनीथिंग ही डजंट हैव टू डू एनीथिंग द लॉ ऑपरेट्स ऑन इट्स ओन अ किंग ऑफ अ किंगडम हैज सेड यू नो दैट दिस इज माय विल द गॉड द किंग इज राइटिंग यू नो विल एंड स्टैम्पिंग इट That whosoever does chori, let us say, thievery, you know, his fingers would be cut. Or whosoever murders, he would be hanged. Or whosoever does some good thing, then he'll be rewarded with gold coins. Then that is his will. That is the king's will. Now he has a big kingdom and somebody out there in a remote somewhere place, you know, has murdered somebody. And he's been hanged. You know, so he's being hanged because of the king's will. But the king's will is what? It is the law. So everything, the king is not even aware of it. The point is, he's not even aware of it. And that, to a certain extent, could even go for Baba. Because when people would come to Baba and say, Baba, thank you very much, you helped me in such and such a situation, this happened, and I took your name and this thing happened, you know. And Baba would very, very sweetly, very innocently and very genuinely say, I have not done anything, Aishapat. I have not done anything. Tell me what happened. Tell me what happened. And the person would relay everything, you know, that this is what happened and this is what happened. So now why is it happening? Because the law is that whosoever takes his name from the bottom of his heart, wherever he may be, will get help. Now he is not even aware. He is all knowing, so he could get aware if he wants to get aware. I remember Baba saying when we say that all knowing and all that, that very beautifully, the example that Baba gave was, and I don't know how Kamatipura came. Baba uses the word Kamatipura. Kamatipura is a very backward lane, you know, that red light area, something like that. That the king doesn't know who all are resident over there. But if he wants to know, he can get the information of that. So in other words, Baba, as the God-man, is not constantly eavesdropping into who's doing what all the time, you see. But if he wants to do, as Baba uses the word, if I apply my mind, you know, that's what had happened in Manzile Mim, one incident took place. We all know that, about the, you know the story. Yes or no?
Yes.
No? Yes. How many yes? How many no? Then,
no.
Yes. Okay. Yes. No. Then we'll say okay. Then if he.